Thank you. Before I start, I want to ask you, do you really understand what this picture means? This elephant is our totem animal, and trunk, and this is a impossible torus, is a logo of JSON. So this, so when I ask our artist to make a picture for this presentation, she asked me what's the history about this. And I said that for many years, Postgres community tried to stay separate from the NoSQL world. We say that we are a relational database. And there are some small world of some hipster people who do some JSON stuff and so on. Yeah, but the real life is complex, and our users start asking us about that we love Postgres, but we also need to play with the application, which is a modern application. They speak JSON. And another group of people, they ask us about JSON in Postgres. They came from the NoSQL world. They start using MongoDB, start using other NoSQL databases, and quickly realize that they need something more sophisticated, more flexible database, which keep, which say very robust and about the data and so on. So eventually, Postgres has got JSON support, and JSON now is a first-class citizen in the between data types of the PostgreSQL. Yeah. So now I will talk about the history of NoSQL features. Actually, 2003, we invented HStore. I and Theodore, we invented HStore for one very specific, one of the case of the NoSQL database. We was working on the system which collected, aggregate metadata from different objects. They have a similar but slightly different structure of metadata. And we have about 50 kinds of objects. And we have to combine it into one table. And this table becomes very wide, like 500 columns. I was very, how to say, angry to work in PSQL with so wide table. And then we said, and most values was just null. So it was very sparse table. And we decided we were working on application using Perl. So we said, okay, there is a hash in Perl. Why not use hash in the, implement hash storage in the Postgres? And then we got just, I remember, 6 columns. And 1 8 columns was just HStore data type, which contains everything inside. And this was very one of the first use case for the JSON. It's to aggregate some data with different structure. Another, we start using this HStore, and our friends told us about another case. They use HStore for storing user profiles or personification, and this was another use case. In 2006, in Toronto, the first meeting where all Postgres developers really see each other, because before we just exchanged email in mailing list. Yes, we presented HStore as a demonstration of GenIndex. And people then say, wow, this is what we need, and they started using HStore. Yes. In 2012, JSON was eventually appeared in the 9.2, but this JSON was just a textual data type and was useful only for storing and verification of JSON. People was a bit upset, and I start thinking about that we need to do something more usable. And we presented at PGCon nested HStore. So it was HStore with arrays, with objects. So it looks very similar to the JSON. But nested HStore has a binary storage, index support, bunch of operators, and so on. Next conference, we generalized our storage. I call it binary storage for nested data. And then we forgot nested HStore because people said, we don't need HStore, nested HStore, JSON. We need just JSON. So we forgot nested HStore, just rename it to the JSONb. Yes, and JSONb, B means some people say better, some people say binary. So it's, what do you like? And it was committed to 9.4. And since then, we see that on this graph, on this plot, it's a Google trend. I made this yesterday, that JSONb becomes, you know, very, very popular. But HStore still popular, still in use. So this is a very short history of... And another one is we expect that in 2018 we will submit some new feature to the Postgres 11 or maybe 10 something. Who knows? We need your help. We need your votes. So after we got JSONb, we have people say that this is a NoSQL on ACID. And I made this picture, you know, the NoSQL databases also evolved. They become a bit, first they was just a simple key value database. Then it becomes ordered key value and so on. It becomes more complicated. But here we have a very good relational database with very strong JSON support. We have a binary storage for them. We have indexing. And I will show that actually NoSQL in Postgres can compete with MongoDB. And I see no reason to use MongoDB. Yeah. Okay. But now we have two JSON data types. You see that? We have a JSON and we have JSONb. So the difference between them illustrated just one SQL query. So the difference, JSON is a textual storage as is. So with all your formatting, with all your, and JSONb has no white space, you see this, no white space, no duplicate case, so last key with win. And JSONb have a key sorted by length and then key. Very important. And it has a binary storage, so you don't need to parse again and again, and it has index support. Overall, JSONb about 10 times faster than JSON, just for sequential, if you do sequential scan. And if you use index, we can get like 1,000 times faster. So JSONb really, really helpful and very useful. I will not talk about all details about JSONb because 2 years ago, Christoph Petrus made a very, very detailed talk about all these features. So I recommend to look on this. Also, did you understand this?
No.
Do you know about JSON and Argonaut? Yeah. So this is very, very nice picture, very nice presentation. Christoph made very good job. Mm-hmm. And here is the conclusion of his talk, that use relational data for the basic set of attributes and all other stuff store in JSON. And forget about JSON and use JSONb. So this is, I completely agree, fully agree with this conclusion. So I save time for the more interesting stuff for the future. Yes, JSONb is great, but you know, we have no good query language. And JSONb actually is a black box for the SQL. But sometimes we want something to talk to JSON and to navigate inside the structure using SQL. For example, let's consider this very simple data set. This is just some artificial data set. It contains colors and some on different levels. And you may think about this as a supermarket or some shop which describes the colors and some goods. And you want to find, to buy something red. Sometimes it happens, you know, you want to buy something red. So with SQL, you have to write this query. So not everyone can write this query for the it's very complicated. It's not easy. It's because SQL was invented for atomic data type. It works with something like integer, string, very good. But if you have a data type which has some structure, SQL can't work with inside, you know. This was a problem. But fortunately, Postgres has very good support of SQL, and writing this complex query, you can do something. But it's not our way. So at PGCon, we presented Vodka and jQuery. I would not talk about Vodka now, but Vodka is a new access method. We are still working on it. And jQuery is a JSON query language. So with jQuery, you can write query like this. You see? Very simple. And very simple and very effective, because efficient, because it also has index support, all these operators. So if you don't know what is jQuery, there is a GitHub repository, and you can download. It is an extension to the Postgres. It works fine. Many people use jQuery. It provides more more comparison operator, indexes support, and search in nested objects and arrays. So it's very good. Why we did not committed the jQuery to the core of Postgres? People asking us. Because we know that jQuery is not the answer. jQuery is just a tool, which is temporary tool. We need some SQL level. jQuery is still, you know, operates with something like black box. Postgres will not, jQuery is a data type. Yeah. So we were looking for the better solution, some extensible SQL language. So, and fortunately, in December, SQL standard, JSON, appears in the SQL standard. So now it is official. I know that Oracle syntax is very similar to this proposed standard. So I think that it's Oracle pushed JSON to the SQL standard. And we started working on implementation of this SQL JSON to the Postgres. Unfortunately, so we discussed this in January, end of January in Brussels. Yes, and after the month, we submitted the patch to the community. But community said that it's too big. It's about 16,000 line of code and 5,000 of regression tests. And so nobody will, you know, we are able to check all this stuff and commit it for Postgres 10. So unfortunately, we will not have this in Postgres 10. We will work for Postgres 11. SQL JSON, it's a new data type. It's not a data type. It is just a data model for SQL. SQL standard doesn't require you have a data type. For example, in Oracle or MySQL or SQL Server, they don't have JSON data type. They have a string, nvarchar or something like this, some container. And do and apply model to this container. But the problem is that it is very slow. They have to parse every time. Postgres made, because Postgres has extensibility, extendable by database, so we can implement a new data type easily. We have all interfaces. So that's why we have a JSONB as a data type, which already parsed binary storage in a very fast, much faster than in Oracle, than in MySQL or SQL Server. We don't need to parse every time. So one question was, we have JSON, JSONB, should we implement something, you know, like new SQL JSON? Three data types, too much. So we decided to work, to continue, to stay with JSONB because it's already usable, very good data type. It support, it is a subset of standard. It is a ordered and unique case. So we will not implement new data type. We'll implement new features of from standard to JSONB. SQL JSON standard contains also specification for JSON path. JSON path, the data type for SQL path language, it's very similar to JS query, actually. It's different syntaxes, but easier to understand. If you know JS query, it's easier to work with JSON path. So JSON path allowed you to navigate through the structure of JSON. You can construct very, very interesting queries. You can do everything with JSON path. And also it specifies the 9 functions implemented as SQL clause. It's not a functions, it's a SQL clause. So we have, instead of something like 60 functions for JSON and JSONB, SQL standards just specify 9 functions because it has a JSON path. So, what for example, how it looks. So it uses a dot notation. So dollar sign means the root element. And then normal, everybody understands this. Dollar, dot, A, B, C, and so on. You can use arrays as a bracket square and filters, which is very, very powerful. So you can specify that the value of this key at sign and x should be greater than 10 inside the path. It's very handful. Mm. And also in JSON path, you can specify a method, conversion method. So you can convert to date time, to integer, to some, take an absolute value, and so on. So JSON path is very, very powerful. You can see that this is a query from Postgres, which use contain separator. And this is a query, the same query, which use SQL JSON syntax and JSON path. Looks similar, but I agree that it is sometimes you need to type too much. But the good is that this is standard. SQL JSON, you see the SQL exists. This example illustrates the usage of filter. So this is a question sign filter and some expression. Expression use named variable. Named variable pass specifies later. Just example. You can imagine that a very simple example, but you can imagine you can write more interesting queries. And we have a SQL JSON construction functions. I will not talk about them because they looks very similar to our JSONB. Arrays, JSONB object, and so on. Looks very similar. And we have a JSON retrieval function, JSON value. It extracts SQL value of predefined type from JSON value. And JSON query, it's a JSON text from, it can, very powerful, it return many, many values. Yeah, JSON table, it's think about unnest for JSON. So it's convert JSON to the relational form. It's very powerful also function. No testing function, JSON exist function, it's also useful. I will show next, for example, this how to use JSON value. So in JSON value, you can specify also returning integer. So we default minus one on empty. So if there is no value, then by default we'll return minus one. If there is an error, so it will return default minus two. So here's the example. And JSON query. Use another example, and the example of using a writer. So we can specify, should we wrap value result to the array, to the arrays. Conditional, unconditional, without wrapping, and so on. It's very simple examples because we have 5,000 lines of examples. Yeah, this is just for easy understanding. Yes, that it is very powerful. And constraints, finally, we can do constraints. This is what people ask about. Now we can do. Let's demonstrate the power of JSON table. So we have a delicious bookmark, and we convert JSON data. It's about 1.3 gigabytes to the relational data. So the schema is very simple. Just column name of type JSONB. And it looks like this one. So the structure is it's complete. So how to convert it to relational format? With the JSON table, it's easy. Not very easy, but it looks manageable, you know, the query. So here we use JSON table can be used only from table, from cloud. So we can specify the nested path, so we can make some cycles inside. And we specify the what to do with the results, inner join, cross join, and so on. You understand that you have to create new relational row with JSON value converted to SQL value. So you have to, if you have, for example, one array, you have to use join inside. If you have several arrays, you have to join between all of them. It becomes very, it's very difficult. And so now we got relational data, and it's relational data in this case becomes about two times more bigger. And this schema, it's just example of JSON table. So an SQL JSON finds something red, looks like this.
It's a bit longer than JS query, but also it's understandable query,
more or less. You can play with SQL JSON already. We have a GitHub repository. Yes, if you want to understand the grammars, BNF is available also. Somebody published it, I don't know who. And we need your feedback, bug reports and suggestions, because SQL standard was written on very specific dialect of English. We Russians, we very difficult to understand sometimes. Yeah, so we need your help if we miss something. And especially we have problem writing documentation. You imagine how to describe, document all these features. would be very difficult for non-native English speaker. Yeah. So the roadmap, we try to push SQL JSON to Postgres 11. We have our fork, Postgres Pro, will be available maybe in May, so you can download and play already. Yes, and another is a dictionary compression. We also plan to push to Postgres 11. Yes, and also will be available in Postgres Pro 10. Yes, and when we will have a sharding, we'll have a real NoSQL database. And sharding will be in several years, I believe, it will be in Postgres. So now we'll talk about JSONB compression. The idea is to have a transparent compression of JSONB and access to the child elements without full decompression of the JSON. That was the goal. And motivation was that I've seen JSON documents with the very, very, very long key, and the value is just true, false, or just integer, or just something, you know. And you, people, and I understand people, they want to have something, you know, normal, understandable, not just F1, F2, key1, K2. So, but it takes so long, so big overhead inside. And people asking us about, could you please make it, you know, something like compression with JSONB? And the idea is very simple, to use dictionary compression. So dictionary compression, it means that you have keys, key names stored in some external place, and in JSON inside, use just ID of keys. And then you can save a lot. For example, if you have key name like 20 bytes, you replace by integer by 4 bytes, and you have 100 such keys in the JSON, and you have 1 million of rows, my 1 million JSON, you can save several gigabytes just on dictionary compression. Of course, if you have long values, the saving will not be so big. Also, we try to compress values, because we try to use to you know, object and array entries. We have overhead like 4 bytes for per array element. If you have eight elements in array, you'll spend just 32 bytes just for overhead. And was 8 bytes for object field. So we can save it using variable byte compression. Yes, but I don't believe it will help too much. Dictionary compression is the best what we expect. But you see that what we use it ideas inside. So keys replaced by the ID. We use delta coding. If we have sorted ID arrays, so we can use a delta coding. We have variable length encoding entries instead of 4 bytes entries for arrays. Yes, and we use chunked encoding for entry arrays and store integer numeric into entry 32 and use a variable length encoding. It looks very strange, but it works. Believe me, I will show you some examples. We implement a create compression method. So you can specify your own user compression method. And the syntax is now looks like create table, column name, data type, and you can specify compression name and some options. But you can make alter table, alter type, and information about compression method stored in the PG attributes. We have two additional fields. It's compression method and compression options. And one implementation of this infrastructure is JSONBC. So it's a compression method for JSONB type using dictionary compression. So we have two possibilities. So you understand, there is an infrastructure and one implementation of compression method. Actually, we tried something like 10 different compressors. We use LZ, for LZ for dictionary, we use Snappy, ZSTD, many, many compressors. But they are not, they work well sometimes, but they are too slow. You have to decompress all JSON to get the value of specified keys. So we decided to stay just with JSONBC, which is a dictionary compression. And it's, you can have dictionaries identified by sequence ID and enum. With sequence ID, you have a fully transparent updates of dictionaries. But if you know predefined key names, you can use just enum. So we have two methods for the dictionaries. Here is the example. We have create table, JSONB compressed JSONBC, and can manually create dictionary sequence and create table and specify this dictionary. You see? We can use enum and manually updating this. And now the results of compression. We have two data sets. It's delicious bookmarks. It's 1.2 million rows. They are mostly string values in a relatively short case. And have two arrays of tags and links of three field objects. So it should be not very good for the compression. And another is a Citus data set. It's a customer reviews from Amazon. It's a 3 million rows. Rather long case and a lot of short integer numbers. So it's a very good candidate for the compression. Yes. Another test we made with a compressed file system is the page level compression, which we implemented in our Postgres Pro Enterprise. It was also interesting how JSONBC compared with the just use compression file system. And here is the results.
Citus data set and the delicious bookmark. Here is a relational table. So it's a JSON converted to relational data, and it's here is the size. Slightly about 700 megabytes. And this is very different in all colors. So this is a compressed file system. So we see that compressed is about 250 and something like this. So it's CFS is good for this. JSON compressed also good. JSONB. Here is a JSONBC. So we see that JSONBC has a very low overhead overhead to the relational data. Yes. But with delicious bookmarks, it's not so good. So we have I forgot to say that here's a wire tiger. The same data we load to the Mongo. So we see this is a Mongo size. And Mongo developers, they made very good job. They have a very good compression. So our JSONBC has a bigger size than Mongo WireTiger. But still, the idea is that of this plot is to show that JSONBC is very good compressed. It's very close to the size of relational table. And also interesting to see that compression file system works very well. So if you have CFS, you don't need maybe just JSON BC.
Yes. The same for ZFS. We did not test ZFS because we just don't have experience, and our engineers said that it doesn't work. But I saw that some people said that it works very well. Yeah, but yeah, I think that we will try, of course, after. But compression is another one side. Another side is the performance, because if you have a very good compression but it's very slow, you don't need it.
So here is the performance of just this query, contains query, and we see that for relational data we have very slow performance, but JSONB and JSONBC have about the same performance. Yeah. So and even better than Mongo. So Mongo is slower here.
Again, JSONBC looks very good. It has a good compression and very good performance.
Do you know what this means? What does it mean? This is we first run all our tests in non-parallel mode. Then we turn on parallel mode and we got this number. So you see that JSONBC and JSONB several times faster than Mongo
in parallel mode. Yes. Another query. How to get several keys?
We see that JSONBC is faster than JSONB. We didn't test MongoDB because we don't know how to measure time in Mongo. They use a cursor and impossible to check how long it takes to get several keys.
Maybe you know, you say me. And very
also interesting with some aggregate. We use this average. And of course, relational table shines, of course. It's very fast. But JSONB and JSONBC still have a comparable results, and also is faster than Mongo. Again, I forgot, we can use a parallel mode. Which parallel mode is again?
Is that the parallel that's now in 9.6?
Yes.
Excuse me, what is the slide showing? I understood the previous one. I haven't seen this.
Mm-hmm. Whoops.
So the previous one was showing performance.
Oh, getting several keys.
Right.
So key. Not just one field, but three fields.
So you see that this performance, and we have, of course, there are some problems. And one problem is transactional dictionary update. Of course. Sorry, I will task. So, mm-hmm. So currently, automatic dictionary updates, we use background workers. And but autonomous transaction would be much better. So maybe it's Postgres 11, there will be some autonomous transaction, we can use them. And also we did not implement cascading deletion of dictionaries. Because for example, if you drop some column, we need to track the dependency if there is some dictionary associated with this column. This is easy, we just did not implement it. And also, we did not implement a user compression method, not fully supported, but I don't know, should we do this? Mm. And the summary is that JSONBC can reduce JSONB column size to its relational equivalent size. So it's very good. And it has very low CPU overhead, and sometimes even faster than JSONB. And compression can be significantly lower than in page level compression than CFS. We need of course, to do something, some work, and availability. You can download from GitHub and play. Check on your data. Now, when we need to do something, some benchmarks. How NoSQL Postgres is fast? Because there are many, many myths. And the first myth I made myself in 2014. It was my first non-scientific benchmark. I first showed that JSONb can be faster than Mongo. Because before people just didn't believe. Before people said that Mongo is very good, very fast. But when I did this benchmark, very simple, very non-scientific, I was surprised that we are faster. We are faster. And you see that time Mongo was very slow for loading. 13 minutes compared to the 40 seconds. It was that time. Then Enterprise DB published their result, NoSQL benchmark. It was a bit more complex than my non-scientific, but people still believe that it's not good. Because all these benchmarks was written by Postgres people. Of course. And people tend to believe some independent and scientific benchmark. The benchmark should be reproducible. They should support more databases, many workloads. It should be open source and so on. So what we did, we implemented, we run YCSB benchmark. Do you know what is this? This is a scientific benchmark available. There is a scientific paper. It's a de facto standard for the measuring NoSQL performance. So we run YCSB for the Postgres master and MongoDB 3.2. It's the latest version. We use two servers, one server to generate load and another server for database. And they connected with 2 gigabit Ethernet. And YCSB benchmark provides 6 core workloads. Workload A, it's update heavy. It's a 50% of updates and 50% of read. Workload B, it's read mostly. It's 95%. Workload C is read only, 100% read. Workload D, read latest. So you insert new rows inserted and then get all this. So it's you get hot. Workload E, it's a short range. And workload F, it's a read, modify, write. So you read, record, modify, and write back changes. And all workloads used Zipfion distribution for record selection. So this is not written by Postgres people. This is written some independent people. And I've seen published results for many, many databases. So now we have for Postgres. We use a Postgres 9.6 sometimes and master sometimes with asynchronous commit on. Why? Because we want to match the MongoDB. MongoDB G0. Because if we use a G1, it becomes too slow, very slow. So you know what this asynchronous commit. So we use two sets of 1 and 5 million rows. And with asynchronous commit off, we were able to run just 100 kilobytes of rows. Because MongoDB becomes very slow. Postgres is optimized for this, but not Mongo. Also, we use fast update off for gene index. This is a problem of gene. We know this. And we tested a lot. We tested functional B3 index for JSONb, JSONbcd, SQLJSON. Functional B3 index for JSONb on compressed file system. Gene index for JSONb, for JSONb build object, MongoDB. We used WireTiger with snappy compression. This is default. And we return a whole JSON. In another test, we return just one field. We use two kinds of JSON, just 10 fields and 200 fields.
This is very important because with 200 fields, the average size about 7 kilobytes, so it's toasted. So we try to see all variants. And here is the result. First, we identify the problem. We identify problem with hot. You know what is hot update? Yeah, so workload A, heavy update, 50% of updates. And we found that Postgres becomes, after some 40 clients, it becomes, the performance drops. And we found the problem because hot doesn't support all data types like JSON, HStore, arrays, because we have a functional index on the one key, but updates different key. And hot doesn't understand this. So this is a problem. So we made some quick fix, of course, for the hot, and then it becomes better. So all other results will be with this fix. Yes, but we need to make a more sophisticated fix. It was quick and dirty. Here is the result for the six workloads. Workload A, B, C, D, E, F. And then the Mongo is yellow. Mongo is yellow, and B3, Postgres B3, JSONB is a violet. We see that on all workloads, B3 functional B3 is on JSONB is better. So Mongo is, you see, always lower. I remind you that this is for 10 fields. So short, rather short, not toasted JSON. Mm-hmm. Another result, it's 1 million rows, 10 fields. And we see that Postgres is better in all workloads. Again, here, Mongo is crimson, or how to say, violet. Violet, Mongo, and all other is Postgres variant. So we see that, again, Postgres is better than Mongo. And we see that Jin is not good for updates. This is Jin, actually. This is to understand. Jin should be not good for update index. But it's okay for selects. For workload C, for example, workload C, Jin is the same as like B3. But Jin has very interesting feature. Jin index all keys. B3, functional B3, key index just one key, like in Mongo. So Jin sometimes could be very, very useful, but not for updates. Now we have results for 5 million rows, 10 fields. We also see the same results, that Postgres is better. Postgres is blue, and Mongo is green. Sorry for the colors. Colors is... I don't understand. Why? This should be green, you know? But it looks like yellow.
Yeah, maybe. But believe me, it's green here. Yeah. Yeah. But we see that all this.
Postgres is better than all the Mongo. So it's 1 million rows, 5 million rows, 10 fields. Postgres is better than Mongo.
Okay, so we made a. 1 million, not 1 million, 100 keys rows. It's just my mistakes. 10 fields, and we use asynchronous commit off.
And we see that Postgres also better in all workloads. Here is the Postgres. It's asynchronous commit off. This is the Mongo.
Okay. Yes, but situation is not very good when you take 200 fields. So JSON becomes toasted, and we see that MongoDB is better on some workloads. We need to understand what we can do. What we tested here is that Postgres is toasted, and we use and we identify that 50% spent to the PGLZ to uncompress it. So we create another test with no PGLZ. It becomes better, but still sometimes we MongoDB is better. So for long JSONb, MongoDB has some chance. In some workloads, of course. So the conclusion is that Postgres still beats MongoDB on one server. That's true, because we don't have built-in sharding, some distributed mode. So we use just one server. I hope that in several years we can repeat this benchmark and see how we are good in distributed model. But I believe that 90% of projects could be run on one server. You don't need, you know, many servers. So the summary of my presentation is that Postgres is already a good NoSQL database. Yes, and SQL JSON provide better flexibility and interoperability. That means that queries from Oracle will run the same as in Postgres, because it's a part of SQL standard. This is very good. And SQL JSON is just the beginning, just starting. I expect this year or next year they will release something more, because SQL JSON doesn't specify any updates, any modified operator, just build and query. And JSONb compression is really useful. Yeah, we also expect in Postgres 11. Postgres beats MongoDB in one node configuration. So we need to figure out how to make a hot for support for JSONb and HStore and other arrays. Maybe we need, it's time to introduce type-specific compression. So for now, we use PGLZ for any data types. This is not good, because for JSONb, we need some another type of compression, for example. So this is also direction of future work, to introduce type-specific. So data type should understand which compression is better for them, not just PGLZ. And maybe we can run YCSB benchmark in distributed mode using Citus. Citus demonstrated there, Citus MX, how to run in distributed. Maybe we can run using Citus. And Postgres will help NoSQL users to avoid nightmare. Yes, we need sharding, and community is working on it. We have two different direction of development using FDW and using Citus approach. So we'll see. So expect it in 2-3 years. And the last the slide is about credit to people behind JSONb. Is Alexander Karatkov, Theodor Sigayev, me, Nikita Golukhov, who made all this SQL JSON stuff in compression. This is Peter Gagan, who helped us with JSONb. Andrew Dawson, who made the first version of JSON and helped us with JSONb. Robert Haas, who worked with Andrew for the JSON stuff. This is Dmitry Dolgov, who also worked for the implementing some functions. He ported actually HStore functions to the JSONb functions. And now he implemented a full text search for JSON and subscription syntaxes, like arrays for the JSONb. So I don't know how Andrew will commit this to Postgres 10.
Full text search will go into that.
Yeah, full text search will go to the to the Postgres 10. And three companies.
Engine Yard was the first company who sponsored us. Was interesting. This is how our community works. They just sent me email and said, would you like to have a get money to work on JSONb? Then Heroku and our company Postgres Professional, it still supported the development of Postgres. Yes, and the last slide tells you think what is today is the birthday of Vincent van Gogh. This is my favorite artist, and this is the elephant, but not by Van Gogh, of course. Somebody emulates the style of Van Gogh, but I like this picture, and so put. Yeah, so celebrating Van Gogh. Okay, thanks and for attention. Yes, I'm here, so you can ask me, and we can discuss everything.
I have a 15-minute break.